Hi, everybody. This is my second time in Zagreb. I came here, spoke here last year for the first time, and I'm really glad to be here. I'm going to be talking about continuous deployment at Etsy. The ideas that I'm going to talk about are more valuable probably for medium to large scale projects that are long term. But of course, many of the ideas expressed here you can take apart for projects of all kinds. So how many of you have heard of Etsy? A lot of people don't know about Etsy. So Etsy is an online marketplace where buyers and sellers from all over the world interact online and offline to exchange unique goods. Think of your weekend market, your farmer's market, maybe your weekend craft market. It's like an aggregation of all of these online. So it's a lot of small businesses. So to give you a sense of the scale that we're dealing with, we have 1.5 million active sellers on the site, a little under 22 million active buyers, a little under $2 billion in GMS, this US dollars last year, and over 700 employees. I think it's probably surpassed 800 now. So my name is Premshri Pillai, and I'm a senior engineer at Etsy. Before Etsy, I worked as an engineer at Yahoo. And just so you guys know, I have a pretty bad throat, so if I take time to clear my throat, excuse me. And if my voice is raspy, I'm sorry, but I can't help it. Okay, so the way I structured this talk is I'm going to talk a little bit of some of the principles that drive how we build continuous deployment at Etsy. We'll talk a little bit about the tooling. We'll go a little bit into the specific tools that we have, we use, that we build in order to get into continuous deployment. We'll also talk a little bit about the culture that helps us achieve a situation where we can deploy continually every day. And we'll end with some questions. So principles. The first and foremost is we just want to ship. We are here to enable innovation. We are here to ship products. We are not here to ship code. In the end, we want to ship products. So that's our goal. As designers, developers, engineers, people who create stuff, there are certain intrinsic motivators that drive us. We want a sense of purposefulness. We want a sense of autonomy. We want a sense of mastery. So we want when we think about the continuous deployment tools that we build, we want to think about how can we optimize for these factors. We don't want our continuous deployment tools to be a hindrance to what actually drives us, what motivates us. So we want to think about these things. Experimentation, A/B testing. So Lev gave a really nice talk some time ago about A/B testing. So we want A/B testing as a way to A/B testing infrastructure to be built into our continuous deployment tool. A simple example, maybe if we want to experiment with two different variations of the homepage that we have and see which one performs better, you can choose whatever metric you want to decide what better means for you. It could mean conversion, it could mean more engagement. But we want to have experimentation be an integral part of our continuous deployment system. Quick iteration. We want to constantly be improving products and features. We prefer to fail fast than have stagnant code lying in our code base for 6 months. The way we try to develop products is we launch it really small. We may launch it to a very small subset of the users and then get feedback and then constantly improve. So we want to constantly iterate, and our deployment tools should allow us to do this. And another idea baked into the whole process is continuous improvement. Nothing is 100% perfect. We can constantly evolve. We can close the gap and constantly get to a point where maybe we are perfect, but we'll never close that gap. But we want to get as close to it as possible. So baked into the process is the idea of continuous improvement. We want feedback from our process and to constantly improve the tools and the culture that help create the process. Failure is inevitable. Systems fail, humans fail, things fail. I think anyone who says failure is not an option is lying to themselves. So we know things will fail, but we want to optimize for having a very low time to recovery, mean time to recovery. So a very low mean time to recovery is important for us. So I'll talk to you a little bit about the tooling that we have in place to help us get there. I will not get into very detail about each tool. You can look at that in your own time, but I'm also happy to talk about it later. So let's talk about what a typical continuous delivery cycle looks like. So as a developer, designer, you may commit some code. that may trigger an automated build. You do some manual testing. Build triggers tests. Then you later on go do some manual testing, and then you release. Baked into each of these phases, of course, is a feedback loop. So if one of the systems or one of the phases fail, you know what to do about it. You know that if your build failed, you can go to the next step. So I will talk about the various things we do in order to get to continuously deploying. One of the things we do is frequent check-ins to master. Does this shock anyone? We don't do branching. We check in everything directly to master. How many of you do that? Some hands. this surprises a lot of people, but actually it works incredibly well, and I'll tell you why. We branch in code. And this is such a simple idea, but it works really, really well, and it's one of the cornerstones of what makes our continuous deployment so easy. We do this using a library we built in-house called just a feature library. It's a PHP API. It's available on GitHub. So very simply, we may have a configuration file. In this case, we have my feature, and we have it enabled to on means it's enabled. You could disable a feature. So it's really just a configuration file. At the application layer, also the feature files, the feature flags we use may be used to have it enabled for a small subset of users. For example, here enabled one is saying that this feature is enabled for 1% of all incoming requests. You may also optionally enable it for 1% of all users. The difference being in the former case, requests are based on a cookie, a UAID cookie. But if you want to base it off users, which often may make sense, for example, if a user sees a particular version of the homepage, you probably want them to see that same version of the homepage next time. So you can bucket it. So you can bucket it based on users, or by the default, it's a UAID cookie. On the excuse me, on the application layer, the API, we have a very simple API, is enabled. So in the code, you just check is enabled. If you want to check for a user, you check is enabled for. It's really that simple. So this replaces branching for us. So on the same similar idea of branching for features that are on or off, experimentation, A/B testing that Lev talked about before, we use feature library for the same thing. So instead of having a feature flag that's either on or off or ramped up to 1%, you may have it, you may give different variations of it. So in this particular case, what we are telling is we have a feature, my feature, that's enabled differently for three different variants of that same feature. So you may have a new homepage feature. You may have one where you have a two-column layout, one where you have a three-column layout, and one maybe you just have two big rows, whatever you want. So in this case, what we're saying is layout one, the layout one variant of this feature is enabled for 1% of requests. Layout two is enabled for 2% of requests, and so on. And in our application layer code, you just do the same simple checks, but now instead of seeing if a feature is on or off, you select a particular variant. So in this case, we are saying, is layout one the variant that's selected for this user? Do this. So also, I won't get into this in great detail, but so the way we do experimentation, of course, you also need to know you need to have metrics. You need to know whether a particular variant is performing better than another. And for that purposes, we have event loggers in place. So in each of the variant checking codes, you would fire off an event. And on the back end, we have big data jobs that figure out what to do. Similar to what Lev talked about, we have a tool that tells us whether a particular statistic has achieved significance or not. In our case, it often can be quite easy. If you enable something for a short amount of time for a million users, you can get data pretty quickly. So all of this ties into continuous integration. Every time you commit, you are probably triggering a build and consequently automated tests. So the idea here is we want to keep the build always green. We want to be able to release at any time. So before any developer or engineer, designer, anyone commits code to Git, we use Git. in case I didn't mention that. So before anyone commits, go to the database. We have something called try. Try is basically a library that sends a diff of your current working directory, patches it up with whatever's latest on master, and then runs all the entire suite of tests along with it. So what that means is, before you get to the process of actually deploying code to production, you can be sure that, OK, whatever you're doing is probably not going to break the build. So this is just a way of making sure you're not creating work for others who may be involved in a release cycle. So you always try before you commit. It's available on GitHub. It's a Jenkins plugin. And you know, once you run try, if the build is green, you know, OK, I'm good to go. If something's broken, you fix it before you go ahead. So the next step is build. This is maybe a little misleading because there could be automated builds, but also once we start deploying to production, we go through a tool called Deploynator, another tool we built in-house. It's an atomic deploy tool that lets us push to production essentially using one button. Also available on GitHub. It's just a screen. I know you can't read anything, but there are two buttons there. That's all you need to know. we'll talk about that in a bit. So once you go through the various stages of deploying, there are two stages. One is staging, one is production. Each of those triggers their own tests. Once the tests are green, you start doing some manual testing, and then you're ready to release. So that button, the button highlighted there is deploy to production. It's just one button. And anybody can push. And I mean that sometimes even dogs can push. But really, anyone at Etsy pushes code, engineers, designers, product managers, anyone can push code almost any time. So the idea here is you need to be anxious when you push code, because in the end, the code you're pushing is going to affect millions of users, a lot of passionate users. So you need to be aware that what you're pushing is probably going to break stuff. It's probably going to cost a lot of businesses money. But you don't need to fear. The idea is you need to be curious. You need to know that something you're pushing is important. But you don't need to be afraid of what you're doing. We have tools in place that make sure you gain confidence in what you're doing. We have tools in place that once you finish your push, you can gain confidence in what you're doing. So this creates a cycle where you are very confident in what you're doing, not needing to be fearful of the push process. So many organizations, I should say, have a situation where developers and ops don't necessarily talk to each other. How many operations people here? I assume many others are developers. How many do both? Not bad. Often, developers write code, hand it off to ops who maybe don't always see or know what code they're about to push. There's just disconnect. Here, we write the code that we build and we deploy. So there is no animosity. There is no bad vibes between developer and operations. It creates for a very good environment. We are all doing this for the same. We have the same goal. Ops build tools that help developers, and we build code that we push out as features. So dark changes. Most of the things that we push are dark changes. Dark changes basically mean very simple things, like if you're doing a small template change, a small CSS tweak, maybe we change the color here, unreferenced code blocks. So like if we are using feature flags and a particular feature is off, and you're building on top of that, and you know it's not going to be referenced, we just push it dark. A dark commit doesn't need the kind of attention that a normal, regular commit would need. And we have social contracts in place. So if I am pushing something dark, I just flag it as dark. So if anyone else sees that commit, they know, oh, chances of this affecting the code base, doing something bad is very, very, very low. So I can ignore this. We also have config pushes. So the idea here is we don't have the same push process for features and also config, because configs don't need to block on features. So for example, if I have my feature, which is enabled for 1% of all users, and I want to enable it for 50% of all users, I don't need to go through the same push cycle in order to push my code out. I can go through a different queue. This makes sure that when we are ready to push a feature, we can push it without it interrupting, without it affecting how this might affect any config pushes that are in place. Config pushes happen more often. We don't want that blocking regular pushes. So we talked about the tools that we use, but how do we do this? We do this through social contract. We do this through IRC. So if you can look at the topic on the top, that's the IRC topic. We have two trains here, one with five developers and one with one. So the way it works is we have a bunch of homebrewed commands for IRC that we wrote. So when I say join, it adds changes the topic to push John plus Framestree, so it says that we both are going to push. When I say in any of the stages of push, if everything looks good to me, I say dot good. You can say dot bueno, whatever language you want. And that gives a star there saying that we're good to go. At this point, if someone else wants to join the queue, say Sally wants to join the queue, if she says join, she will get her own queue, and she becomes the driver of the push. We do this using pushbot. The command grammar and the topic grammar is written in Antler, and it's available on GitHub. So the release cycle, we divide it into staging and production. Now, the important thing to note is staging, we call it Princess. It's just a bunch of depooled production boxes. So that means we can replicate as much of our production environment as possible. So post deploy, now is the time to gain confidence in what we've done. So we have a bunch of tools that we do for that. One of them is called SuperGrep. It's also available on GitHub. SuperGrep is basically an aggregation of all the error logs that you see on all your different systems. It makes it very easy once you do a push, if you see that your logs are running because of a particular problem in one of the applications that you worked on, you will notice it pretty quickly. We also have a tool called SuperTop. I don't think it's open source, but it's basically like MySQL Top, so it shows you all the processes or all the logs that account of the logs so that you can really quickly know if there was an increase in a particular error. We also use extensive use of dashboards. We have a lot of deploy dashboards. Now, this here is are a bunch of generic dashboards, so if there's an increase in 404 errors, increase in lack of account creation, but there are also, and these vertical lines here are push lines, so a red line is a normal push, another line may be a config push, so we can align when a push happened and when errors or the path of the graph changed. We also have application-specific dashboards, so each application builds their own specific dashboards to know what metrics they need to look for when there are errors. We use StatsD for logging of this, and we use a combination of StatsD and Graphite, also available on GitHub. I'll go through the summary really quick because I'm running out. So everyone probably knows what this is. This is the standard Ethernet cable. There is really no way to go wrong with how you put this, and that's based on the principle of Pokayoke, which in the Japanese is mistake proofing. So a lot of our tools go with this idea that you want to avoid human mistakes as much as possible. I'll talk to you about culture. Culture is not created by any one person. No one owns it. We create our own culture. So there are some guidelines we follow when we try to think about this. We always want to assume best intentions of other people. We are all in this together. We want to cultivate empathy. I think it's useful for me to know what it is to be an operations engineer and vice versa. That creates a trusting environment. We want to be open to ideas, solutions, critique. And failure is an option. This is not to say failure is an expectation, but this is to say that failure is a reality. Failure happens. We don't want to criticize anyone or blame anyone for failure. And failure is really one of the biggest opportunities for us to improve our process. So we go through a process called postmortem, which is exactly what it means. And the remediation items that come out of the postmortem are what we feed into our system. We have a tool appropriately called MARG. MARG is where we log postmortems. So what happens is, say, a push caused a failure in our system. What we might do is we will huddle together in a room after we have fixed the problem and and go through it in great detail about what actually went wrong. We will come up with ideas, we will come up with a hypothesis. Sometimes the postmortem may take a long time, but the idea here is no one's being blamed, we just want to get to the root of the problem. Morg is also on GitHub if you want. We also at one point had a three-armed sweater award, which was given out to the most spectacular failure of the year. Not because it's funny, but because I think you learn a lot from big failures. We also have a tool internally called Mixer, which is it's an opt-in tool where you sign up for it, and every week, at the start of the week, it'll pair you up with another random person at Etsy so that you get to know all these people as a way to cultivate empathy. You meet them, talk about whatever you want, meet for coffee. So to summarize what we've talked about so far, we have a combination of culture and tooling allows us to get to a point where we deploy continuously. Most times we succeed in deploying. Sometimes we fail, and failure leads to an opportunity to remedy our system, to make our system even more resilient. So at this point, we are able to deploy around 30 deploys at least every day. We do around 30 plus config deploys, so that's around 60 deploys every day. And we don't even think about it that much. It's so ingrained in our culture and so ingrained in the tooling that we have that it's just another day. I could be doing a push after this. So there's a bunch of resources available on the Etsy CodeAsCraft blog if you want to take a look. Also, all of these slides have links to the tools that I've already talked about, and I'll put them online. That's all I got. Thank you. Also, I know every speaker has mentioned this, but I think we would all really appreciate if you give feedback to every speaker. My link is there, but you should give feedback to everyone. Thanks. Take questions.
Anyone else over here have questions? Great.
I don't know if this is a stupid question or not, but...
There's no stupid question.
Well, sometimes, but... So you covered like basic deployments and pushes and config and things like that, but what about ones that have like really big impact, like changing payment workflows and delivery things that could actually affect things happening there and then and break them? How do you handle those sorts of more mission critical pushes?
We don't handle them differently, really, but to give you a little bit more context, we often, when we are doing big changes, for example, changing the look of the homepage is a pretty significant change. It could affect conversion. It could affect a whole lot of things. So the way we would go about that is to have a feature ramped up to a small percentage of users, like say 0.1%. We also have an idea of, we have groups within Etsy. It's etsy.com/teams. So often what we would do is we would ask sellers, we would tell people ahead of time, buyers, sellers, that we are about to make some changes. Maybe we are about to launch this product. You can join this group if you want to check it out early. So we may experiment with that group, get feedback from these people. Then only then is the next step, which is to ramp it up to 1% of all users, then maybe 2%. And also we wait to get significance in statistics so we know that, okay, this actually works and we are ready to turn it on. So, but the process is the same. It's, well, maybe it's a little different, but it's the same flow.
I have a question. It's kind of connected to what he just asked.
Sure.
With feature flags, so if you have something that it's a feature related to logic and there's interdependency between different logics, how do you handle that? Because maybe a certain combination of features could just break it.
We don't handle it is the answer. So the problem, I think the problem you're referencing to is that in an application code, there may be many switches, feature flags, if conditions, and that's the reality. So that's the downside. And one thing to be aware of when we do this is that once we are done with a feature, we want to get rid of these flags. But we don't worry about it too much. We have a lot of if conditions in our code, and that's OK. But we clean it up when we know that a feature is 100%. We get rid of all the config flags.
Okay, quick question. What about versioning?
versioning in what sense?
How do you handle rollbacks, versioning?
So when anything goes wrong in a deploy, we just revert. We don't have the sense of, because master is always so up to date, we don't have to worry about going back too many versions. So if one of my commits affected something breaking the system, I just need to revert my commit. I don't need to worry about 10 different things. And because we use feature flags and we're constantly checking things in, we don't work on something for 2 months and then suddenly push something to the mainline. So chances of that happening are very, very low. And it's very rare that we have to actually do a revert of any kind. So we don't worry about like this version of the homepage on another.